Alright, here we go. From a dark basement in a haunted dwelling, somewhere in a black swamp in northwest Ohio, this is Swamp Gas, and I am your host, Arizona Tramp. We've got an awesome show planned for you. I'm not going to do any news. I'm not going to do anything like that. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to play the song that I have by Ed Roman, who is my guest. And then after that, I will read his bio to you and I will introduce him. Hold on tight. Make sure you're sitting down and make sure your pants is on. Just like happens in live radio, I cannot get Ed's bio to come up on my computer. So, anyhow, Ed Roman is a Canadian indie rock artist, and he's a teacher. He teaches music. He's a brilliant musician. He has had many paranormal conspiracy stuff things going on here. All right, you have to forgive me. I just had an incident inside here. Nobody heard, so I'm a little shake up. Anyhow, Ed has a new album out. I'm at the lack of trying to figure out what that is at the moment, the name of that, but we can recover this. We can get it going good. All right, and he's won awards for his music. And I'm just going to jump right in now. Ed, how you doing, buddy? And thanks for being here.
Hey, Paul. It's good to be here, man. Thanks for having me. And hello, Ohio.
So you're in Ontario, Canada, correct?
Yeah, I'm in Ontario, the Great White North. You know, Central Ontario, you might say. South Central Ontario.
So how's the cold for you?
It's been a mild winter, man. And, you know, I'm a farmer as well. I grow a lot of food and come from a big background of farmers. So, you know, I'm always paying attention to the weather. And it's been extremely mild. We didn't really have much snow until, like, January. And the last, you know, month and a half has had, we've had extreme cold. Extreme cold, like well below the dipping point. So, you know, I'm happy spring is coming because I'm getting excited about gardening again. And, you know, I got lots of little things bubbling with my vegetables and some trade things going on and people interested in buying some of my food. So, you know, other than growing it for myself and family and friends, it's, I'm you know, like right. Canadians are obsessed with the weather as it is. So.
We've had mild weather. In fact, this weekend, our weather is supposed to be back up into the 50s again, which is one strange February, man.
It's supposed to be 40 here on Saturday and Sunday. So, I mean, it was minus blah, blah, blah the other day. So
we're going to do that gardening thing, too. We've got the acreage to do that here now, and that's going to be a blast. So, right. All right. I didn't get to your awards, and I didn't get to your accomplishments right off the bat because I couldn't get your bio open, and I apologize for that. So could you tell our listeners just what's up and what those awards are for?
Well, sure. I'd first like to thank Mike Stover at MTS because a big part of those awards happening are his efforts and through MTS. And Mike, there's been multiple awards and nominations over the last couple of years for the record, and I'm in the precipice of releasing a new record for the spring of 2016. So with that, you know, that last tune you played, Jamaica, it's a lot of fun to play that tune, and it was fun to have that kind of come into fruition because it also won some awards, and along with some other tunes on the record, right across the United States, a lot of great independent organizations that are really helping out independent music. So having that, you know, and not necessarily something based on, you know, popularity contests and guild voting and what have you. It also got to the point this year where 7 pre-Grammy nominations for a bunch of the tunes on the record. So with that said, a lot of work and a lot of time and energy, you know, there's been a lot going on. And, you know, I've been doing this for a long time, you know, as long as I can remember, I've been writing stories, and that's what I am. I mean, I'm a bass player by trade, but I play multiple instruments, obviously, you know, guitar, and I'm not going to go into the inclusion of it all, but the reality of it is that there's always some element of storytelling, even inside of a melody.
Right.
And you know, if you, like you, you're a lover of music and all kinds of stuff, there's language happening in that melody that's telling a story. And I was lucky enough to be shown that at a young age and appreciate that too inside of music. So for me, that's the baseline thing. I'm always trying to talk about us.
So how long have you been doing it since you were a kid? I think you told me 6 years old.
Yeah, about six, you know, like playing tunes at the old farmhouse, standing on an old milk crate into a broken lamp. You know, John Jacob Jingleheimer Schmidt, and, you know, and anything that, you know, I learned from my grandmother and brothers and sisters and parents, and then my parents would be like, look, he's a ham. You call me in, and like people would be there eating breakfast or lunch or dinner or whatever, because I was a very busy household. So it was like, I always had an audience, right? So for me, I went, hey, this works. I like how this feels.
Yeah, that always helps when you have an audience and they can give you some feedback about whatever you're doing.
Well, and in return, though, as well, being exposed to such a wide range of people in a household, hearing those kinds of stories. I just finished being asked to write a part of my life story for a book that's being released out of Nashville on the Josie Show, and I thank her kindly for that.
Cool.
And that I remember these moments at an early age, where the house and the transoms were all connected to that old furnace.
Right.
And you could hear the conversations and laughter and storytelling even that my grandparents would tell, like stories from the old country. And that's where, you know, even my love for the paranormal began on that level, right?
And where is the old country?
Slovakia.
Slovakia. Awesome.
Yeah, so if people like Czechoslovakia, that's usually the first thing a lot of people say. You got to remember, Czechoslovakia was three separate countries. It was Moravia, Bohemia, and Slovakia. Slovakia is the most southern part, touching Hungary in that area. So, you know, it was a cross-melding of language as well, too, and culture, because it was like the hub for a lot of different things, right?
Right,
so it was a very interesting time frame that they came from, which was the late 1800s, 1900s. My grandmother was born in 1900. 1908. So, you know, this is a very different time frame, and a romantic time frame, a time frame where people were gentlemanly enough to one another but still go to war, you know.
So what was the transition? When did you, or when was your family brought over to Canada?
Well, my grandfather saw the change. He saw in the 20s that there was a lot of political upheaval, and being a part of the Austro-Hungarian experience in that war, you know, being a prisoner of war, escaping, being shot, gassed, all of that, he saw the writings on the wall and thought, if I don't get out of here, I'm going to die.
Right.
And sure enough, you know, 50 to 60% of my family were rounded up and put into concentration camps. But he left at a time when, you know, it was the Depression and there was no work. And he built coffins for 2 years while he was here,
cool,
just to make enough money to bring my grandmother and my mom and my the other side of the family is a completely different story. But that aspect is in the 20s of that era. And it's funny because it's like, you know, the things that he would say to me back then as a young kid before he died, like he'd roll up his pant leg and he'd show me the hole where the bullet had come out of his calf and his shin, and he'd say, "See this, Eddie?" And I'd say, "Yeah." And he'd say, "This is for," you know, as kids are so empathetic too, because you can almost feel the pain,
right,
by actually looking at it in that level. And he'd say, "This is from a rich man's game."
Oh,
you know, and I'd be like, "Whoa, what, you know, what is he talking about?" It took me years, you know, even my young adulthood to try to figure out what he was talking about. But the reason I'm here today is because he took those steps.
Right, right. So tell us a little bit about your teaching of music.
Well, I fell into it because it was ironic. I graduated earlier than I thought, and I ended up with a lot of free time in my last year of high school. And one of my teachers, Terry Anton, who was like one of those teachers that you always wish you could have or have had, took me under his wing and said, "You know, I'm going to help you get into college." And at the same time, he's like, "Look, you got all these spares and everything. Why don't you start teaching grade nines and tens?" So I did, even back then in high school. And then when I got out of high school and I was in college, I was also sort of at the same time supplementing part of my income while I was going to college, teaching on the side. And then when I got out of college, I did a lot of playing. But at the same time, you know, it's not always paying the bills, so you get right back into it again. A lot of smaller schools all around where I was living. And then I was teaching at the conservatory here in Alliston for close to 5 years. And then I started my own school, where I've been, you know, mentoring kids that are going from the high school stage, a lot of them, into the college or university level,
okay,
you know, that kind of a thing.
Right,
but I
right.
still teach young kids. I love young kids. I had some developmentally challenged kids I was working with for a while. Just whoever's willing to feel it and learn it, you know?
So whoever just wants to come right up to you and say, "Hey, man, can you teach me how to play guitar or something?" And you just go from it for...
Well, yeah, hour. I mean, you just played the tune Jamaica, and the reason, like, I wrote that tune, and it's funny, you hear the opening track of that, the acoustic guitar, people's like, "What is that? You got, like, some kind of a thing on there?" I'm like, "That's a garbage bag that I put over the acoustic when I cut that track," and I call that the Jamaican guitar case. Because it's raining in Jamaica in the early mornings, we'd get up, get in a car, drive to Kingston or somewhere. We were doing different things, and through that whole experience, I was teaching kids. Because that's the thing, man, about Jamaica, and another reason why I wrote the tune is because tactically, kids are still so excited there, and they aren't inundated with the Western form of technology, which is,
oh, yeah,
you know, a conditioning experience.
In other words, they're not destroyed.
But a kid wants to learn. I go, "Hey, no, what do you want to know? You know, let me show you something." So for me, it was like a no-brainer to, you know, like, want to keep doing this and do it with anybody, even Dizzy Gillespie. Like, people would ask him, "Hey, Dizzy," he's on the street, and they'd start chatting, and they'd ask him a question. He'd pull him into a cafe, grab a napkin, and try to start explaining what he was talking about. That's the whole thing about music on that non-egotistical level, that it's a continual transformation and cross-pollination of ideas, hopefully, that is always bringing new concepts to stuff. So I'm always, "Hey, man, you want to, let's sit down. Like, I got time. Like, I'm not gigging right now.
We have a question.
Yeah, man.
Night Sky is asking me, what is the state of funding for the arts where you are located in Ontario, Canada? And what is the interest of the youngsters of learning the musical instrument?
Well, here's the thing. Funding for the arts has been cut back in multiple ways, and this is another reason why smaller schools are so busy, and even in the grade school systems, those programs have been cut, and it's not necessarily a good thing. And even when I was younger, back in the 70s, they started doing that, and I was, like, devastated when I found out, you know, I couldn't have my hands on an instrument, like a real instrument, and have that sort of, like, we had the cool music teacher at the school, and those classes just looked like so much fun. So that part of it is something that the public itself is fighting and dealing with on its own. The funding in terms of grants and certain kinds of things for the arts in the country, I mean, you got to write grants. They're very involved. It's no guarantee you're going to get them. There's umpteen amount of things that they're based upon. At the same time, there's umpteen amount of types of grants that you can get for certain things.
Right.
So that, with that said, you know, it's a crapshoot, just like a multitude of different things. And that's why I think so many people in the arts, not just music, are multitasking in order to keep things working.
Yeah, so, it seems like it's all up to us as musicians to keep this going, because here in the States, in city schools, they don't teach music anymore.
Well, see, that's not cool.
And it's absolutely disgusting as far as I am concerned.
Well, and you know, whether it's part of a higher agenda or not, but I always poo-poo this, there's not enough money for it or the right type of curriculum. That's all horse hockey as far as I'm concerned. So, you know, yes, it is, it behooves us to talk about it, teach it, to set up schools, do whatever we can to pass on the information. That's the rule of thumb for all of the arts in that regard, is that mentorship concept. Even the things that my wife does with her pottery groups, they're younger and older, different people that are involved. They're not always the same people, but they're always sharing concepts and ideas, critiquing and going through this. But that's the funny thing about the industry, the music industry, is that it's also extremely cutthroat. So there's also a very me orientated environment.
Right.
And less people, like you say, more musicians got to be sharing the share, right?
Right. I was about to take this that direction and go into the music industry itself and the difficulties around the industry and the problems with being paid for just to make a decent living, or the problems in being paid just to be able to go over the border, like we were talking about, and play your music there.
Well, yeah, that's where I think that, like, a lot of times the public doesn't realize that there's a lot of effort, money, and time and energy to go and do some things that are like that, like even big festivals, and you're putting down money to play sometimes. I mean, even in circumstances I know of in the past, major artists putting down a lot of money in order to open for major artists in Europe for 36 dates. This isn't an uncommon thing. So it becomes very difficult when you're trying to make it a business, a personal business, a micromanagement of what you're doing. That's why I say so many musicians and artisans in general have learned to multitask and do so many different things. For me, it even goes as far as growing food to make sure that I'm healthy and that I'm active, because a big part of gardening is physical. So, you know, that all that said, it's like, yeah, you sometimes wonder why we do what we do, but the important thing to realize is that art comes from passion, just like anything anybody does. If they start a radio show, to paint a painting, to a sculpture, the byproduct hopefully is some sort of recompense in a materialistic fashion that you go, yeah, I can pay my bill. But the art was created for another reason. If it isn't, it's not art.
Right.
To me, it works from that perspective of your perception of your moment in time. Once again, I'm going to quote Herbie Hancock. The definition of an artist is one who has the ability to fuse their life with the rhythm of the times.
Yeah, I like that quote.
Me too, man. I even with students, I've used it before, and it's like almost epitaphic. Like, you know, it has that quality to it. Yeah. So I always have to remind myself that, and you know, to me, that's the aspect of it. It's not about And that's the thing about the industry that shows itself as that Leviathan, that it's all about the ego. And look what's going on with the press, and I want to get bailed up by so-and-so and everything. I'm not even going to go into it because you know what I'm talking about. But it's like artists just want to function. You know, they don't want the gold airplanes and hot and cold running, whatever.
Do you think it's more robust overseas?
Well, I do. And I know a lot of people who have moved overseas that are functioning and working just because the culture's a little different, and it's more root-oriented. That's even just like the West Indies. There's still a flourishing community of people that are working and people that are participating, and it works on that root level. It doesn't have to be the normodome factor all the time. Well, and I guess that's also what artisans have to remember is that, and I'm always reminding people, hey, man, in your backyard, in your local pubs, in little places, there are some amazing things happening.
Oh, there are some awesome people in these little pubs that you will never see on stage, on a big stage, promoted by a major label. You'll never see those people, and a lot of those people don't even want to go there.
Dude, I've seen things recorded in people's living rooms in Hungary that make my jaw hit the floor. You know?
Oh, I've heard some stuff that the same thing. I've heard the same thing.
Yeah, or just people being creative on that level. And it kind of, you know, it's like I love movies and directors and script writers, even like John Milius and Coppola. In one of those interviews that he said, so what do you think is going to happen to filmmaking? And then I think it was in a filmmaker's apocalypse. It was about him making Apocalypse Now. And he said, I think that the next Mozart's going to be, and here we are talking about Ohio, some little fat girl from Ohio that'll have her dad's handicaps, kind of dating it, and will become the next Mozart. And that's kind of what's happening around. There's this new renaissance of a shift of people more in, this is, you can thank social media as much as we can sometimes look at it, poo-poo it, for showing at least people that are, you know, smart enough to share it and go, check this out, this is amazing, this is wild, this is, so it's a fascinating time that we live in, and we're always continually navigating it. Maybe that's a good thing because it keeps you on your toes.
Well, it's also the thing that pulls a lot of people down. I mean, everybody does this, and they go ahead and they make their CD and they send it in to somebody, and they don't even ever fucking have the opportunity to listen to it. I dropped the F bomb there, but they don't even have the opportunity, you know, to listen to it. And if they do listen to it, they pass it on by, and it's crushing to the people because they can't get their music out. Oh, and there we go with a mind fart.
That's the thing, like. I was talking to my mom today, and she's been a little under the weather lately, but I'm always trying to cheer her up and vice versa, you know, like we're always a wonderful connection that way, almost third eye on a multitude of levels. And this other lady had hired me for a gig at the museum in April, and I said, Mom, you know what, this lady's so nice, and I love her work, and it's so nice to do it, and she's just I said, even if I was gigging at Madison Square Gardens, and she asked me, could you come? I wouldn't have that. No, I'm sorry, I can't do that mentality, because to me, the intimacy of it is also just as important. We have to remember that the commodification of so many things can be a dangerous thing. The important thing that things need to become created, and that eventually that will happen. Everybody's trying to play this materialistic catch-up in somehow, and rightly so, because we also need to live and function and pay our bills and have a roof over our head and food. But the important thing, again, is make the art. Make it happen.
Yeah, no doubt, make it happen. And the difficulty, what is your difficulties with the fact that you get enough people that decide that they want you to play down here in the States? And what's the problems with getting over the borders?
Well, in terms of audience?
In terms of just getting over the border.
Well, the politics. Look, as far as, okay, so the Austin, Texas gig last year, or the New York City tour, PA, Philadelphia, that kind of stuff was, I go to the border. I'm actually in a lot of cases not getting paid. If I'm doing anything, I'm making merch money. They will usually ask me at the border, and I've talked to the American Federation of Musicians, Canadian Federation of Musicians, who actually don't warrant proper P2 or B1 visas in order for you. B1, ladies and gentlemen, means you're going across the border to work, you're not getting anything, you're coming back in a certain period of time.
Explain to the people what the visas are.
The visas basically are paperwork, which means you're actually checked out by Homeland Security. It's a background check. They are a detailed account of what you're doing during on that little tour during date A to date B, where you will be staying, where you will be playing, how long you will be playing, are you getting funds, are you getting hotel accommodations, are you getting food, are you selling merchandise, how much are you taking with you. There's a large list of things that sort of curtails, so they understand on an economic level what's exactly occurring, because this is what's ironic about free trade.
Yeah,
it's a whole other show. But it's not easy in that regard. So for me, honesty is the best policy. If I talk to a border guard, they ask me questions, I honestly answer. I got nothing to hide. I got axes in the back. There's my guitars. May have an amp and a pedal board if I'm going down playing solo. Or if the band's with us, usually there's a back line for a festival. So there's a kit and guitar amps and a bass amp. We just sort of plug in and go, bring your clothes, and that's it. So with that said, you know, I'm just like, okay, yeah, I'm going to New York. I'm playing six nights. How many CDs do you have? 100. How long are you going for again? Six nights. When are you coming home? Well, I'm going to PA after that. How long are you going to be in PA? Okay. All those little questions come up. You know, I got anything in the car to declare? No. Okay, have a nice time.
It also goes to, okay, you go to Detroit, you play in the casino.
Right.
And the casino pays you your money, and then right off the top, they get 60% in taxes or something?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, so basically, all the money that you spent to get over there, it pays you back for the money that you spent to get over there. You make no money at all.
Right. Well, that's why they're, in that regard, just like, you know, it's good to do certain things because it's healthy. And I think that's where some of the, let's say, anger or maybe frustration from that, let's say, product level. See, I put out a CD. Here's the ultimate thing. I put out a CD. It's not a lot of people buy CDs anymore.
Right.
It's now available in MP3 in every blah, blah, blah location that you can think of. Plus, it's also here on Spotify and blah, blah, blah. Okay. So now, with all that said, there isn't a lot of interaction on that merch level from people. So you have to sell it. I'm walking around talking to people with CDs. Once I had my wife dress up like a 1950s cigarette girl with the box, but it was filled with CDs and T-shirts. Hello, CDs, scarves, hats, you know, pretending that she's like, just to try to get people interacting with that, because that also offsets then the other issues like you just mentioned of like, okay, we made X amount of money, but it cost us X amount of money to do this. So at least there's some recompense, and that's why people need to have merch and do that, because, man, I got offered 50 dates with a certain artist a little while ago, and it was, you know, you have to pay for everything, your accommodations, your travel, whatever it is that you're doing, food, and the only way you're making money, they're not paying you, no ticket sales or any percentage of it, is merch.
Right.
So you're dependent on that aspect of it. So
for those who don't know, what is merch?
Merchandise, hats, shirts, stickers, buttons, you know, anything. You know, at one point I had lunch boxes with Special Ed and the Musically Challenged with the band, and it was a whole thing that I did with airplane inside of it, condoms, pencils. It was just a weird conglomeration of stuff. The band's shot was on the front. You know, I bought all these old Scooby-Doo lunch boxes and slapped new stickers on them and did them myself. That's the other thing. People don't realize that sometimes you're doing these things yourself in order to create that interest. So you have to think cleverly inside of it, almost artistically inside of it.
Right, man. I just put up your website in the chat room.
Oh, great. Thank
you. And what can they find when they go there?
Well, you're going to find photos, you're going to find links, you're going to find articles, all the blogs that I've been doing, any shows from the past and I've had the pleasure to be on. They have all my social networking buttons that are there for Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. You can buy the album there. There's going to be some new merch going up there with some new shirts soon, merchandise. So all that said, you can also get my app for free at iTunes for your Android or iPhone device. It's free. It's totally free. And it basically gives you MP3s that you can listen to now from previous records and videos and all those same links.
That sounds good. For those who are not in the chat room, the address for this website is http://www.edroman.net. That's www.edroman.net.
Okay. Yeah, baby.
And I wanted to make sure that I got that in there on this time because, you're the first person in a while I've had to put the website up, so.
Rock show, man.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, kindly. I mean, it's just always cross-referencing, right? It's like farming and growing things. I mean,
well,
it never ceases to amaze me, cross-pollination. Sorry, what were you going to say?
I'm going to tell you, I do want some more of your music.
Yeah, baby, I'll send you some.
I mean, I do.
Fire me your address, and I'll send you the Ed Roman package for the station, which is a whole bunch of CDs, man, and a T-shirt.
I'll list the email for anybody. The email is webmaster@unknownspirit.com, which is the main domain for Black Swamp Radio.
Okay.
And from there, you know, because that was like the first time I had heard your tune all the way through, and I was like, wow. I played it twice tonight, by the way.
Oh, thanks, dude.
Yeah, I played it twice tonight. So, anyway, are you going, you've got your music and you've got your farming, you want to go back into farming a little bit?
Farming is something I'm always going to do, man. It's in my blood. This is one of the things about family that I find fascinating too, and also in a sociological level, the disconnect in many ways, is that I was as tough as it was growing up in a house of eight people in a little tiny farmhouse. It was a cultural three-generation thing, and those ideals on a baseline level are shown. And for me, like I said, it's in my blood. It goes way back to the old country.
Well, there we go.
You know?
Ed, there we go. We have just established what's going wrong with a lot of things, is that we don't have family to take care of family anymore. You have to do it yourself. We have children with one parent that the one parent, you know, if they're worth their weight in gold, they don't have the time to dedicate to that child so they can do anything extracurricular like music or like sports or anything because they're too busy providing for that child. And we've lost a great deal by not having the whole household living together like in the olden days.
We've got pills for that now, boy.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But see, this is the thing about the shift in what that is. And I understand people like, yes, you know, that we have busy lives and career. Yes, this is true. People are trying to play this materialistic game of catch up, and we, you know, it was Don Henley had said, you know, hey man, the only difference between me and you is my pile of shit's bigger than your pile of shit, and it's true because ultimately it means nothing, and if you go back even and look at old commercials and what was popular and fads, and it's all just so really irrelevant in the grand scheme of things. What's more important is your contact with your living environment, which is your family. It's your parents, it's your grandparents. My grandmother lived with us till she was 92.
So what kind of farming are you doing?
I came from big farming. I mean, not corporate. It was big family farming. So we had 150 Holstein that we milked twice a day, and we had Blonde Aquitains, which my dad was a cattleman because he also studied political science and agriculture at the University of Guelph. And he brought a type of cow into the country. It took him a year to do it in quarantine. It's very different laws and regulations than today.
Yeah.
That's another show. But he had a passion for that, as well as my uncle. And they were what you call old school breeders, which meant that they had the ability to look at animals, especially my uncle, and say, crossbreed these two animals and you're going to have an incredible animal. So much so that in 1975, on the front cover of Time magazine, you can look it up, he sold a calf that he crossbred at our farm that was sold to the Japanese for $1.6 million.
Wow.
Okay, that's one calf. And in 1975, $1.6 million for one calf.
That's astronomical.
Right, because the lineage of that animal has so much incredible potential and milk value, it's unheard of. That's why this whole concept of geneticizing farming the way that it's come into practice is a load of crap. I've seen it firsthand as to how strong herds are built and how they are allowed to flourish in their own existence, and by paying close attention to what that is, just like a gardener, you start to see what needs to occur. You just play the subtle hand of, hey, can I get you a room for the night? Kind of a thing. And before you know it, your herd is getting stronger and stronger and bigger and bigger. This is what people don't realize on a corporate level, and the death of the family farm, and talking about even the death of the family unit and the way that works sociologically, that sustainable farming is so easy to sustain. That, you know, that's the thing. It's the practice that of the need and the want to do it, aside from the byproduct of the money. There's an adage here in Canada, I live in old farm country and come from old farm country, is that if you can afford to farm today, you can afford to retire. But the reality of it is that, again, it behooves us to do this because it makes our herd stronger.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying? So yeah, for me, it's all that experience with what that is, it was cattle. It was growing food, 1,500 acres of cash crop food that we grew for ourselves, monster gardens. My parents' garden was 2 acres big.
Wow.
Like, we were on 50 acres, and a good portion of that was subdivided. And you got a cornfield, you're rotating crops, you've got corn, barley, wheat, alfalfa, rotate.
You had to have a good number of people there.
There was 50 of us living within a mile and a half.
That's quite a bit of people.
Yeah. Seven farms.
Yeah.
It was almost like a Mennonite commune. But the thing was, is that it was just something that we did. We all had a part to play in it in some way. And because of that, it wasn't anything that we looked at really as work. Yes, I got to clean shit out of the barn today. Damn, I'm going to smell like a pig, and I got to crawl through this tunnel to fix this elevator chain to help bring the manure out of the back of it. Yeah, but there was also a great deal of victory inside of all those little things that occurred. You fill a barn, man, at the end of the summer, and you sit back, you go, holy cow, I can't believe we did this.
Right.
You feel in the winter, and you clean out a barn, and it's tough to clean out a barn in the winter. You bed that barn down, and the animals are in there. It feels like Noah's Ark or something. You go, my God, this is so incredible. It's so peaceful. Yeah. They're all just standing there breathing and quiet and silent. You don't have those kinds of experiences at a theater or on your phone, man.
Or in the city.
You have different experiences. But this is my point. There needs to be a balance, a continual perception of what that balance is.
Well, what do you think about the people who think that food comes from the grocery store and not from a farm? You know?
Yeah, but that's just it. And why, I'm going to see posts of kids that are talking about food, or people saying, bring gardening into the public school system. Yeah, man, as far as I'm concerned, and being a teacher as long as I have, you should be, especially through the growing seasons, in any state that's capable of growing all the gardening for 9 o'clock or 8:30, and the kids get there till noon. Academics from noon to 4. And not only that, there's this clearing of the mind, clearing of the senses. There's this physical activity that occurs. There's this reconnection to the excitement of seeing these things occur. And then you start to realize, man, what they're putting in the grocery stores is not cool.
No,
and how they're putting it in the stores is not cool.
No,
it's not. I mentioned NAFTA before and the free trade agreements and stuff. Man, if I go to the store and I see, you know, why are tomatoes coming from Mexico? It doesn't make sense. We have greenhouses that are closing left, right, and center here trying to make a profit, but it's cheaper for some importers to bring it from further away because they're selling it for cheaper. They're picking it green. It's always being sprayed. And if people don't know and they're listening to the show, the number codes on your vegetables, the PLU numbers, those relate to the growing practices. If you have a four-digit code that begins with a 3 or a 4, those are heavily sprayed vegetables. Those are vegetables that have a lot of pesticides from the beginning of the process till the end of the process.
Right.
And five-digit code vegetables and fruits.
And
sorry, what were you going to say?
The fact that Monsanto has got the monopoly in this country, even though that this country can't take a hint from other countries banning Monsanto from being used at all.
Oh,
they
yeah.
just go well, along but, and but they poison Canada's everybody.
Got a whole
they
thing going on
they
here,
don't
man,
care.
When it comes to that. Like, you know, I mean, it's no coincidence, man, that Monsanto in 96 set up their headquarters on the University of Guelph, which is the oldest agricultural college that we have in this country.
Right.
And my father went there. Many people that...
Know, all they see, know, all they see is the buck. All they see is the money. They don't want to do any... All they want, they don't care. They poison the people. They put the fluoride in the water. They put the other chemicals in the water.
Well, it's all connected to the same thing.
It's all connected for the same reason. Right. And I believe, and we'll talk about it later in the show, I believe that it is... because they want to keep you down. They want to mess your brain up so your brain cannot start to grow with the abilities that people are starting to have now. They do things like the algae bloom in Lake Erie. Toledo couldn't use their water for 3 days because toxicity levels were so great that, at least that's what they claimed, that... everybody had to have bottled water shipped in, and this is, you know, the year before what happened up there in Flint, and that's going on right now. But the whole problem with that is Monsanto, the runoff from the chemicals that the farmers use that runs off into the lake is what causes the algae bloom. Before Monsanto, there was never, ever, ever an algae bloom in Lake Erie. And it doesn't just, it kills the fish, it kills the other life in the lake, and it's poison to humans. I can go on and on and on. And
well, I
don't
know,
care.
And
it's
the
just
thing,
the
man,
fucking
because,
freaking
like, if
buck.
You ask the EPA, they'll tell you everything is okay. So now, you're a man of common sense. My friend the other night, Kyler Davenport, on his show, he says, if it walks like a duck, talks like we know this adage, it must be a duck.
Right.
And the public knows it. But we are forced through these lobbyist groups to have our hands tied, as you said. Look what happened in Michigan with the water sources and stuff that were going on. People's wells were drying up. Okay.
Yeah.
They were forced to basically fight Nestle. Nestle said, sue us. They used their own money, public money, to do it. While that was happening, there was an injunction put on Nestle, but they violated it, said we'll pay the fine, kept pumping water, and at the same time lobbied the government to award them a swath of water a mile wide of Lake Michigan. Now, I ask you then, that means on that level, on a corporate level, there's more clout in the government than the citizens have. And the citizens are the government. That's the way it's supposed to be.
That's the way it's supposed to be. But the citizens either don't have the time, don't know how, or do not care and think it's somebody else's problem. They'll do it for them.
Right. And as I said the other night, too, shows like yours or other people's that are discussing these kinds of things, or even willing to talk about it on the street, buying a hot dog, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. The point is that it's people need to communicate about it and then react in terms of, well, like, their dollar value. I have no idea if there's water issues, why anybody, and we all know there is. I mean, and many years ago, psychic lady that I knew very well, she says, one of the biggest issues you're going to be facing with your generation when you get into your 40s and 50s is people going to be fighting wars over water. And my friend, we're not too far away from what that is.
Yeah, I know. I know. I can see that coming now.
So why do people keep buying bottled water with the fear that the water is not safe? Well, and I know it's why it's not safe, because look, man, turn on your tap in Michigan and all of a sudden you can light it on fire. There's, like you said, the blooms that are going, all of that makes it suspicious. So the public needs to create a group which is outside with the assistance of still hopefully not corrupt municipality system as the watchdogs of their personal space. Because if it's not being looked after on that level, on a unity level, they need to come together like that, and then it becomes kinetic from municipality to municipality to municipality. Exactly. Then it's all of a sudden like, okay, no, we got too many names.
Yeah.
So we got to stop doing this. And the public takes responsibility again, as opposed to saying, look, man, yeah, you're the government. You know what's going on. EPA said this. It was in the Wall Street Journal. Blah, blah. Nah. If it walks like a duck and talks like a duck, we got to do something about it.
Yeah, we definitely have to do something about it. No doubt we have to do something about it, because if we don't, it's just going to get to the point where Toledo, for example, the water problem with the algae bloom, their answer is, let's just dump more chlorine and other chemicals into your drinking water to the point where that just becomes so toxic by itself that it messes with the children that are growing up. And they don't care. They realize this. They know. I've talked to several people, and they know that it's Monsanto's doing. But instead, they're going to go after the farmers and fine the farmers, because the farmers, they can't help it, but the water runs off. It doesn't matter what they do, but they go after the farmers. It's not. They need to go after Monsanto. They need to just get rid of Monsanto. But until things like that happen, it's not going to improve, and it's nobody's problem but ours. And if we don't step up and do it, it's not going
to
happen.
Well, that's what I mean. And if the public is there to support whoever it is that's going through a dilemma, whether it's a homeless person or somebody in a community that decides, oh, we want to set up a public vegetable stand, you know, whatever it is, the public needs to become more active, because all the other semantical aspects of life aren't as nearly as important as critical mass, you know. So that, you know, that's why I'm always trying to encourage people to grow food, because once you also start having that experience, you start to see things very differently.
For people,
because you're doing it. It's not just something you talk about.
For people that don't know what real food tastes like, you're in for a treat if you ever have it.
Man.
Because I'm going to tell you what, a store-bought tomato and a tomato that you grow right proper out there in the backyard, they taste totally, their world's different, man. They taste different.
Well, and here's
they
the thing, conceptually, if you talk about it with your community groups and you say, look, it doesn't make sense to buy a tomato right now unless it's hothouse and somebody's growing it down the road. Because it's not in season. Well, one of the things that hit me one of the things that hit me was when I was in the West Indies in Jamaica, people were like, you guys are crazy up there in Canada. And I'm like, what do you mean? Well, yeah, I know, but why? And she's like, you grow all those pumpkins and you carve them and you don't eat enough of them. And I'm like, she was educating me. She goes, man, they're so high in vitamin C, man. Really? And I'm like, oh, yeah. And then going back, realizing, well, of course. Squashes and gourds and pumpkins were things that were stored by our settlers, and we do it now. We store a lot of pumpkins because you weren't getting oranges, man. You weren't getting citrus that was coming in shipments and trucks every day. Look, it's just magic. It shows up at the supermarket.
You know, it never dawned on me that you could drink pumpkin juice.
Oh, it's good, it man. Never, you mix it with a few other things. Whew.
It never dawned on me. It's like, wow, what the hell is my problem?
I know, and it's like, well, people are like, oh, they're all veggie and all freaked out and tree huggers. No, man, it's called health and common sense. You can grow 50 pumpkins in your backyard and have enough vitamin C to take you through the entire winter.
Wow.
Very easy to do. There's pumpkins that, if they go funky, okay, I sort of monitor the pumpkins, keep them in bushels, and I stacked them going down a staircase. We live in an old farmhouse. So I keep them down to dark, just enough temperature, cool enough, but not warm enough, Okay, so with all that said, if I throw one of those pumpkins into like what we call lasagna garden style compost heap, which means you've got bigger branches with smaller branches on top with leaf litter and compost, which we compost. If I throw that pumpkin in there, that pumpkin will grow better than some of the pumpkins that I mound and plant from seed. So you don't need a lot of, you know, knowledge. You just have to pay attention from moment to moment and year to year more so as to what the thing is doing. This is another thing about perception, and here we are in a paranormal show, is to how things are perceived by people and what becomes clouded by the quote-unquote matrix.
Well, there we go. It's about that time, I guess. We can go into the paranormal side of things now. You know, I've been dying to talk to you about that because we didn't really talk about that too much. You
know, bring out your dead!
But the whole perception thing, the whole thing of what I was just talking about with the water, with the food, one of the reasons that the government is allowing this to happen is because people spiritually and physically both are starting to regain their abilities that are natural abilities that they can do mentally with different things, be it ESP or whatever the hell you want to go into here with this. But they want to block it. And one of the things fluoride does is it wraps the pineal gland and it stops it from functioning properly. And so you can't pick up on things that you should be able to pick up on. Like, you know, as simple as your dog wants out and it's like, what do you want? What do you want? What do you want? Well, just wake up a second. The dog's telling you they want to go outside. And that when your brain gets poisoned by all this kind of crap, then you lose the ability to be able to communicate, not just with people, but with everything else in life.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, and the pineal gland, if people don't know, it is an eye in itself.
It's your third eye.
It has rods and cones.
It's your third eye, man. It's your third eye. It's
absolutely. And it even in ancient cultures, in Indian culture, in so many different, the concept of the third eye, this is where the bindi, and one of the reasons why it's adorned, is because it's this also the awakening of consciousness. If you look at the Pope's staff, on top of the Pope's staff, you will find an acorn looking like pineal gland shape. In the Vatican of the golden pine cone, you will find a 30 some odd high golden pine cone in a chalice. In ancient Mesopotamia, there are multiple shapes that exist like this. Egypt, this what you're describing here is exactly that. And through what you're talking about, with sodium fluoride's a big one, aluminum, there's so many that retard its use and shrink it. And this is even where, you know, for me, as far as connection goes and meditation or other things that sort of enlighten you, and even in a sense of state of peace, where you don't have to have the pants and you're in a yard with six people going ohm, I'm just planting and working with my hands in the dirt, that those moments can occur and show themselves, or even in the most unlikely moment, when, well, almost like
what you just described is when you're busy working with your hands in the garden, that is a form of meditation.
Well, it sure it is. And like other things that are sort of repetitious or you know, in that it's same token, not metaphysical but physical, you know, all of a sudden hearing this humming, stand up, what is this? Out of the field comes hundreds of bees that are following the queen to a new nest, and I just instantly started to weep because I went, my God, I've never witnessed anything like this in 40 some odd years of my life, and I felt honored. Like, in a way. So that, to me, like, awakened me in my emotional senses about how I was feeling about that moment.
That
and even outside of the other things that almost are like a thief in the night, you go, what just happened here?
That would
I can't believe this just occurred.
Yeah, that would have been awesome to witness. I mean, just the fact that with where I'm living now, and I get the glimpses of the animals. Or we have a stork. Never tell anybody this story yet. We have before it got cold, we had a couple storks out here where the geese in the pond across the street from me, and the stork came right up, and he's 20 feet in front of me, and he lands on a telephone pole, and he just looks down at me like he's talking to me, trying to talk to me, and like he's also, you know, trying to figure me out whether or not I'm going to be one of these jerks that try to shoot him or something. And it's like, dude, that doesn't work.
Well, you know, but we're all fascinated with a show like The Dog Whisperer. Isn't that amazing? You know, this is the thing. Like, sometimes things are shown in plain sight, and people go, I don't believe it. But then it's on television, and people are like, isn't that amazing? And it's like, but wait, I just told you I had an experience with my dog that was like that. You didn't believe me. You know, that. So for me, also, as well, other than the allegory of whatever has existed in my life, the personal experiences are always a learning experience. There's always something else aside from whatever it is, the spiritual or crypto-spiritual aspect of what's happened, that makes me start to look at things a little differently.
Okay.
And I guess that's also the idea of, like, keeping your senses open and not suppressing them on that level.
Lorraine wants to know, had Ed noticed a change in the number of bees, and has he seen a real red ladybug or a monarch butterfly?
Yes, we have monarchs here, which is nice, and I know that they've been in jeopardy, and there's been actually a huge influx in Ontario in the past couple years. And that's one of the reasons why I don't kill, or we don't kill, my wife and I, any of the milkweed that's been growing in some of our perennial flower beds, just so we're encouraging them to, hey, look, you got a cool place to hang out for a while, like, kind of a thing. The decline in bees, I would definitely say, is a yes factor. I've noticed what it seems to be, is it Lorraine? This, like, sleepy-esque, zombie-like behavior in bumblebees, especially for the first 2 months of summer. They almost seem confused. And I've definitely seen less honeybees and nest-making of all kinds of Pompiliad. If anybody knows, that's Latin. Pompiliad is a type of wasp and bee species, multiple connections to different kinds of... I study them. I'm fascinated, actually, by them.
Right.
But at the same time, my grandfather kept bees. I have a friend of mine who works for telecommunication companies, and he works on towers, and if he's done a job up there, they're cleaning piles of bees off of the telecommunication towers. And I also know a byproduct of the pesticides, as you mentioned.
Yeah, I think they're being poisoned by Monsanto, but I also think that Wi-Fi has something to do with their problems, too.
Oh, absolutely. I think it's confusing a multitude of things. I mean, I shut it off at night. When I go to, I have to try to, like, get that tick, tick, tick woodpecker signal out of my head, because I can actually almost feel it sometimes, especially when you get closer to your signal system. It's very easy to feel. It's like when I was a kid, if you walked past a room with a door that was closed, but the volume was down and the TV was on, you could still feel that it was on.
Right.
Somehow, you know what I mean? Right. So it's the same kind of thing. And again, once again, it's perception, I guess. So we're always inundated with it. Yeah. That's the issue, right? You have to separate yourself from it. Otherwise, it's continual.
You really have no choice but to separate yourself and go somewhere where it's quiet. To go away from the Wi-Fi. I mean, the Wi-Fi is going to surround you in the city. You can't get away from it in the city. You have to take the time, even if it's once a week, to go out and just go to the park or something that's out of town and sit there for an hour or so and do your thing. You really have to do it.
Fresh air, I mean, or just a different visual experience, you know. So
tell us about the background in with the paranormal that you were telling me about. You said something. You said something about... to me about how your grandmother or someone did readings for somebody, or how far.
Well,
that's
another lady from the family. Where it really began for me, because again, it's the family stories around the dinner table or Christmas or, you know, whatever it is.
Right.
But my grandmother's brother, his name was Ergy. Crazy old world name. And he was born with all of his hair and his teeth and could already speak.
Oh, wow. Really?
And this was something that you ask anybody in my family, and they will tell you all the same, and it goes back to records. I mean, there's records in the church where we grew up, or my family came from in Slovakia.
Well, what year was
he existed.
What year?
But what was wild? Sorry.
What year is this?
This is 1904. Okay, so the turn of the century.
Okay.
And so my grandmother was just a little girl. But at the same time, he would already, like, at a very, like, when he was five, be hanging out and talking to people just, like, out of the blue, like, conversing with them and stuff, almost like he was, like, a mystic. And he started to tell my great-grandmother that I'm going to die when I'm 11 years old, and here's what's going to happen. And it used to just, my great-grandmother, Ayers, you don't talk like this, it's not going to happen. And he said, no, this is what's going to happen. I'm even going to start practicing my funeral, he would tell her. And he said, you're going to press my little suit that I have, and I'm going to put it on, and I'm going to go underneath the tree. There was a tree in the yard, and there's a wood bench that my great-grandfather had. I'm going to lie down there, and I'm just going to go to sleep.
I don't know how I would handle it if my kid came up to me and told me.
Well, they'd probably be on a pharmaceutical or in some building or something.
No, I don't believe in that.
Not right now, right?
I don't believe in drugs, man. I don't.
No, I know. But that's the thing, is that this is where it's such a different time frame in terms of experience, and less of the electrical age of what we live with every day. So with that said, stories of strange beings that my grandfather had seen that were so tall they could step over stone fences. And you got to remember, this is at a time where he's riding around Europe on horseback. You know, 1910, 1920, into that era. And so for all of that, also my grandmother came fully equipped with a whole grouping of spells that were from the old country, not anything bad, but to help on the individual with what they were going through.
Right.
And she also was very, very spiritual lady, and very into the idea of the power of intent. So she would, when we had a friend of the family, a story with her, she, you know, he had cancer and he was diagnosed, it was terminal, and Baba, she would make this soup every third day. And she'd say to my father, Tony, you have to take this soup to David. Okay, my dad, okay, you know, he's a busy man, doing everything that he did between being a mayor, a cattleman, you know, he's a very passionate politician, all that stuff, public servant, sorry. The reality of that is that she believed that that soup healed that man, because the doctors were baffled. After about 2 months, he went back for tests, and he was completely clear of cancer. And they written him off. And my grandmother, she was very, it wasn't like I'm just using potatoes and this, and it was a specific kind of potato soup that she would make. But the way that she did it, and what she felt about everything inside of it, made it what it was. And you know, the irony of it was, is that she didn't tell my dad that this is what it was. She didn't tell David that this is what it was.
So there was no subliminal type of stuff going on.
No.
Had no
and,
clue. See,
and witnessing these kinds of things as a kid made me go, "What? I'm looking again. I want to see more. I want to see more." So now, some people on a psychological level will be saying, "Well, that's the brain, you know, doing certain things in order to placate itself. Like when somebody passes away, we start seeing things in the network that, you know, remind us. It's just like when a woman is pregnant, she sees commercials for light bulbs and diapers and da da da, all that stuff." No, there are far more exterior aspects to my personal experiences and family experiences that make you go, "That's impossible. There's no way that could have occurred." And that's, for me, why I don't believe in coincidence, because so many aspects to those situations are showing themselves to you, and it's ignorant of you to ignore them for whatever reason.
Yeah, I agree, exactly.
When my uncle died, and I was close to him, and he was a diabetic, and he'd lost his legs and his hands and his part of his vision, but he always had that crazy mentality, you know, and sense of humor. I'd call him, "Hey, Uncle Les," or he'd call the house, and I'd be like, "How are you today?" And he'd lost his legs. He'd be like, "Oh, I'm tap dancing, man." You know, just to throw it at you, you know, just to kind of jar you, because he had that personality, feisty and smart guy, right. And passionate guy. When he died, so I was a coffin pallbearer, you know, and that night I had played a gig, and it was this whole series of events that day. We get home from the funeral, and we're in the house, and every family's there. You're having sandwiches, people are having some beers, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, just...
The doorbell starts ringing, and we're like... And, you know, immediately what I thought to myself was, it's Uncle Les. And everybody's like, oh, somebody's playing Nicky Nine Doors, right? So you go to the door, there's nobody there.
Yeah.
Close the door. The doorbell rings immediately again. Okay, what's going on here, right? Over and over again for 10 minutes, these things are occurring. Wow. So much so that later, my cousin's boyfriend and I go down to the basement, flip the breaker off that's controlling the doorbell, and it keeps doing it.
Really?
Yes.
Now that
and everybody, the 20 some odd people, five of us or whoever was in the house at the time, all went, it's Uncle Les. He's screwing with us. And we all were elated. It was like that. It was like he's here. Every guys, yeah, I'm gone. Glad I'm done with that bullshit. I love you. It was confirmation. So for me, it was like, holy cow. So you start even trying to rationalize it. So here I'm driving. I've got an hour and a half drive to get home. I got a gig that night. So what happens? Terrible snowstorm. Walk into my house. And as I go into my room, there's a little step that goes down because I was living over a garage at the time.
Okay.
In the center of my bedroom is a fly because I used to do a lot of fly fishing. And like to, but regardless, was tied by my uncle, and I kept it as a totemistic thing in my fly vest in a box down in the garage. I don't know why, when I opened the door to the room, that thing was the first thing that I saw when I turned on the light in the room. It was sitting on the floor, and again, it was like, how the hell? That's impossible. It's impossible for that thing to transmigrate through a floor 50 feet away in a vest in a box and be played. There's nobody in my house. We're all gone to the funeral. I bring my mom home. You know, all this is going on at the same time, and I was just like, I lost it.
Okay, Lauren's got a question for you.
Yeah.
Did your Baba hide symbols of embroidery or... Paiskena, I don't know how to pronounce it, now known as Easter eggs?
Oh, yeah, she did, actually. She did a lot of Easter egg embroidery, especially when we were younger. You know, she got, I mean, my grandmother died in 2002, and she was 96. So as I got a little older, she got a little bit more, you know, unstable. She dealt with a lot of walking issues, but she always, you know, kept going. You know, I can't see anymore, but God loves me, and I'm going to keep going. That's her, was her mentality, right? Yes. So, but she did a lot of that when we were, and a lot of the cooking in the house. One of my passions for food comes definitely from her and my mom and my dad.
Okay. Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, she did that. She actually did those Easter eggs. You dip it. You wax them. They're painted. You to keep re-dipping them. And it was an interesting thing. Those are also Yugoslavians.
Lorraine says well. You nailed that accent. By the way.
You like that accent? That's Baba. She's always dead, kiddo.
You sound like the guy from Moose and Squirrel, Rocky Bullwinkle.
You know, that's the thing too, even in my house, it was like, with only three stations on a television that we grew up with, one which came from Buffalo, New York, you know, old Irv Weinstein and all that stuff, we had a lot of fun on our own. You know, my dad, I was just talking about this the other day with my wife, and I said, he was so humorous. You know, he was always kidding around and making voices, and despite he was a very serious man and a very devout public servant in federal and municipal politics, that jovial, always levity-like experience helped deal with everything else. So I learned a lot of that from him, you know, as much as like he wasn't an entertainer or whatever, but man, he could really tell jokes and put on some good voices. We're all kind of like that.
So anyway, we got off topic. You were talking to us about that fly from fishing that you found on your floor.
Yeah, so for me, again, it was that confirmation, just like the doorbell, for that, the push, because it was an intense day. Snowstorm, funeral, cemetery, coffin, you know, all of that, to go down and play that gig and not even show it, you know, and just play like it meant like everything to me. And I played the gig for him hard that night, you know. I was right. Really, so it that perception of it, people like, we write it off, well, you caught it on your pants.
I got a question for you.
Sure.
Can you feel, because I know I can you feel when someone's there but they're not, but they're there and they're listening to you? Like they're just sitting there right next to you with their face and on her hands, and they're just looking at you and listening to your play even though you can't see anybody there. Can you feel that?
What, on a spiritual level?
On a spiritual level, can you, when you're sitting there by yourself playing?
Yes, both the good and the bad. Because to me, there's a duality that exists on that level. And I think it's much of it is manifested even by us. But sometimes there are these moments where... And it's hard to describe to you know, without sounding hokey and corny, but for me, I've tried to, and still always will keep trying to, make my instrument an extension of me. And if I can allow myself to do that, I kind of am not here sometimes. I try to follow that message like it's a light. Or like I'm a bug following another bug, a light bug at night in some way, and you lose that perspective of everything in your peripheral, but somehow you start to feel other things. This is even where I think the concept of, and I've said this before, I didn't write this tune. I don't know where the song and these lyrics came from. They just came out so quickly in this way that I couldn't ignore them. And it was like somebody was telling me something.
Yeah, it was like you were channeling is what you were
doing. Right. And when you have that moment, and it's humbling because you figured out the connection, multiple connection points in the writing, it's like you're hearing almost this applause or approval in behind the cosmic spectrum of things. Without, like I said, sounding hokey, that's the divinity to me in the light of any kind of exploration and enlightenment in something, even if it's something simplistic like, oh right, this is what the tomatoes want, or something bigger than that, that it's all part of the same thing. And I think that's what people have to recognize. There's no such thing as insignificance or something that's better
not.
Than something.
Everything is, we're all one.
Yeah.
And when we accept the fact that we are all one, then life goes so much smoother. Night Sky has a question here. I haven't even read it yet, but has he ever had a dream and woke up to write down or play what he heard in the dream?
Yes. There's a song I wrote from a record from Special Ed and Musically Challenged called Caveman Wednesday, which is really more of a look at myself in some ways. But I woke up one morning, I was living with the band in the city, we had a house and place to jam, and you know, it's crazy fun times. But this melody, which was more like a cross between a melody and a bass line, I couldn't get out of my head, and the first thing I did was pick up my bass, and it just started to come out. And it was like I was hearing it almost like it was in my dream again. And it was very easy and very quick to figure out, because like it was there already. And I've had these even other experiences, even aside from a musical level. I remember, he's a Canadian, you gotta skate, man. I had a lot of trouble skating when I was a kid, and I had this dream one night that I could see myself, you know, the pastures would flood, so we, you know, put our skates on and go skating on the puddles, right? I could see myself skating on the puddles, and then the next morning when I put on my skates, I could like almost do it.
Wow.
So that's what I also think about the power of intent, or if people want to call it prayer or whatever it is that it can manifest in ways that we can't even comprehend. Even on a chaotic level, we don't even understand the repercussions of what those energies are. A PK manifestation, a psychokinetic manifestation, can be generated by human beings and through their own negativity and actually take on an existence.
Well, there's three aspects to that: the manifestation, expectation, and the intent.
Right.
All three of those work together, and if you, well, basically, you can just make anything happen with that.
It's the cultivated and non-cultivated aspect of it. You were mentioning before in your earlier question about the predictions, and I mentioned this lady. And Patricia Krillick, and I'm very honored to say her name.
Well, how has the music from your grandparents' era influenced you?
Oh my God. Eastern European gypsy melody-like stuff. The Oracles and Ice Cream album that I had put out just before Letters from High Latitude is filled with that. And it not like it took me years to embrace it, because it was always omnipresent, like old tunes from the old country. My grandmother would always be singing, and we learned them as a kid. I mean, I spoke Slovak before I went to grade school, and I started speaking English when I got to grade school. So that is a big part of me. And it plays a role in ways that people don't even really see, because I present it in other ways, and they don't even realize they're listening to a gypsy-like melody.
Right. Well, the other question, I'm trying to get all the questions in the chat here. I'm trying to do that for you guys. So
wicked.
Ask away.
Honored.
Has he ever heard of Grant Cameron's theory of musicians having the ability to have UFO or paranormal raised awareness?
Yes. And this also actually is something that Pat Metheny and Jaco Pastorius had believed at one point in time in the early part of their career. And it's funny how many musicians I know that have had these kinds of things. And I mean, you could maybe chalk it up to the fact that, look, you finish a gig at 2 in the morning, you got a 3-hour drive, you're looking at the sky for 3 hours. You might start to see some things that, you know, maybe people that are asleep don't. Same thing with truck drivers. You know, often I hear people talking, calling paranormal shows, and they're seeing something while they're driving on the road. Yes, but also I think a lot of musicians are attuned to that other space, which allows those kinds of things to maybe be perceived in a different way.
Well, musicians have, in order to let your music flow, you have to open up, and that's one of the reasons that musicians have this ability that others seem that they don't.
Well, yeah, that's it. Otherwise, it's rigid, and it's just, you know, going through the motion. That's, for me, why a part of what I do is improvisational, because there is framework, but if something happens, go with it, because it's meant to. You know, that's why I fell in love with jazz music, because it has that life and entity to it. Here's the framework, but let go. What are you feeling? What's calling you? What's being shown here? How are you supporting this? What do you want to say? How do we summate this? All of that is alive and happening in the moment. It's an incredible thing. It becomes a musical PK manifestation. It becomes the positive side of what that is. And for me, it's a highlight of being a musician to participate in stuff like that.
I think it is too. I think it's awesome, and I think that I want to hear more about some paranormal stuff that is going to come here. I want to know. I want to shift it a little bit. Is that cool?
Yeah, man. Anything you want.
I
want
to hear. From what I understand, you have UFO experiences, and I know Knight is anxious to hear those.
Okay.
So let's just go into the UFO aspect for a second here, and tell me about what happened to you I don't even know, because we didn't talk about this.
But no.
Did you have a sighting, or were you abducted, or what?
Abducted, I don't know. Nor do I think I
pulled that out of my ass real good, didn't I?
My brother spins a tale about a strange light. No, but what it was our family had a large encounter, all of us, and the only one that wasn't present was my father, who was at work. And my mom was making dinner, and it was an old farmhouse, you know, kitchen, sump pump right below it, with you know, the water tank and everything. And when it turned on, you know, the pipes would vibrate and sink, and sometimes the old window would rattle. And so this started happening, and she thought something was going on in the basement, you know, flooding or something. She went to the basement to check it out. When she came back up to the top of the staircase that opened up to the little bay window in the kitchen, she noticed this light that she actually ducked because she thought it was a plane that was going to hit the house, because we live so close to a small aircraft airport known as Buttonville Airport. So tiny, it's called Buttonville. And she just sort of said, everybody's like, she realized it wasn't moving. And she said, look out the window. And what we saw was an oblong shaped, it's like egg-like shaped almost, with lights that were fluidly moving, excuse me, through each other in a way that you could say were red and green and blue and whatever, but they didn't last long enough because of that fluidity to say that they were stable. And it was only, that was only occurring in like the lower third of this glowing ball. And the thing about it that I guess alarmed my mom too, because it was so bright, is that it was like an arc light, if you know, like from welding. You got to wear glasses and you got to look away, and it's dangerous to do that, that you have this feeling about the light that you shouldn't be looking at it. So in the process of looking away, you notice that the light is so bright, but it's not casting any light, because it's dusk, because it's like late October, early November, and you know, the sun sets early, so this is happening at 6:30 in the evening, and you're like, that's not normal. Like, you should be seeing a shadow, even when the little lamp post would turn on, that was on a timer, you'd see all the shadows as a kid, you'd run and try to jump shadows and stuff, but that never happened with this. And then it, like a ball, it sort of lifted over our barn, which was an old bank barn, and it, like a ball, started to kind of follow the geography of our field, which sort of started to slope down post pasture into a creek bed, and then up again, and then down again. So that's why it was creating this ball-like effect, like following the topography. And then eventually we lost sight of it because it moved down so far to the southwest, like kind of towards over another small town southwest of it. So, okay, the next day my mom picks up the newspaper, and the local newspaper, UFO sightings in the area, 6 different sightings over the course of these 3 little small towns from the local Tribune that came in. And then the local airport has reported tracking different things at this moment in time. The Dunlop Observatory had mentioned they had seen something strange on an observation night. All this thing was sort of showing itself like we had an experience. So for me, it was, you know, again, it's a part of the allegory of our family, of something we all participated in. And it's funny because my dad, who was the only one who wasn't there, didn't believe us when he showed up. And my mom had to show him the newspapers and say, look, we saw this, you know, like kind of a thing. So for me, that was my earliest experience with that kind of a thing. And you know, here again, the creek, and growing up in this old farm, and a person had died there in many years ago, because it was a 130-year-old farm in the process of building the silo. So that area was a hub for a lot of interesting things. I'll just say that.
Right. So you saw, that was the only experience that you had then?
No. I mean, later on, and that's the other thing, as time goes on, the dinner table conversations at Christmas, my grandfather was working in a combine, a field. You do this late at night sometimes, especially when the weather's nice. So you're out late, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock at night. This round oblong ball again, and it was like just post, 5 years post that time frame, basically landed about 250 yards away from the combine.
Wow.
In the actual field that he was approaching. So, you know, as you're cutting, you've got the swathed area and then more to cut.
So it
landed like in the actual corn area.
It landed in front of him?
Yeah, about 250 yards in
front
of him.
Did it leave any markings?
No, it didn't leave anything. It didn't leave a mark. It didn't mar the corn. That's why I say it was more like a strange orb. But my grandfather said it was like humming. And at the same time, and this is where this connects to even my experience that happened years later, this vibratory quality to the visual aspect of it that makes you feel it's not good to look at it. That it's so bright and it has this vibration to your eyes. Like I know people don't have this experience, but sometimes when music's really loud in a studio and you look across a console and you see a digital screen, it almost looks like you have a visual distortion in the output of the light signal that's coming from the right. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about.
I know
right?
what you're talking about.
So that same, or if you got a drummer that hits his snare really hard and does a rim shot, you get that temporary. What? The, So it was that kind of a thing for him. And then he said it stayed there for about a minute because he stopped the combine. And he said if he felt it like it was like watching him. He would say, you know, he'd always squeak his lip when he was talking. It kind of was like it was watching me. I could feel like you have that feeling, you know.
Yeah.
And then it just like he said it shot up. Boom! Just like a light, like it disappeared. But it didn't disappear. He said, I know it went up. I could see who. Would like do this thing with his hand, right?
Yeah.
So that was another one of those family experiences. And then later, I was coming home with my sister because again, it's like there's five or six farms that are all on that stretch inside of a couple miles, and we were coming back to my mom and dad's place because we were at a different farm doing stuff. And as we pulled in the driveway, I could see all of us. Like, it was like we like approached it. A round red like ball that was, and I didn't have issues so much with like looking at it, but the center of it had that a feeling to it, like it was a pinpoint thing, like a very bright center that was swirling white despite the rest of the ball of it was red, and it was very stable in terms of shape, but it seemed very smoky during the center again, almost like that same first experience we had with the orb in front of the barn. And it was moving abnormally and not quickly, but it would change speed and duration of speed, and the way that it was moving would be like up on an angle, on a 45 degree angle really quickly. Then it would stop, it would hover for just seconds, and then slightly move back in a parallel fashion, not parallel, but a horizontal fashion, very slowly, like it was like looking at whatever just shot over again, and then it would shoot again horizontally much further forward, stop slowly, sink slightly again, move up again, and then it would go back to where it was again really quickly. And then we watched this, and I got out of the car because I was like, what the hell is this? And when I, if I was to try to judge it, like to visual, if you put your hand out and you looked at your thumbnail, it was about the size of your thumbnail in perspective to a circle at distance. So if I'm to judge it between cornfield to cornfield, because that's what it was, basically two cornfields away from me, it's about a quarter of a mile. So it had to have been pretty big to have been whatever it was.
Right.
And I got out and I was at the tree line, but here's the thing, even like some of the other paranormal things that have happened, as elated and excited about the experience occurring, you're also terrified in some ways, because I'm so interested also in the subject matter that you can't help but not be inquisitive as a human. So, but I had this fear that if I went, it wasn't a good idea if I went into the field. And my sister-in-law refused to get out of the car. She kept calling me, Edward, Edward, come back here, come back here. And I was just like in a state of trance. Because I was like ignoring her, and I was just like, and at one point I was like, shh, you know, like, why, be quiet, like, big deal, like, you know, like, you, looking back on it now, it's just stupid to think to do that, but, you know, and then we both kind of watched it. She stood in the car, stayed in the car, and I was at the field line, and again, it was just kept doing this till we lost sight of it in the, northwest, which would have been, you know, 5 to 6 miles away from where we were. So it's like it was almost searching for something. And to this day, she refuses to talk about it.
Wow.
She won't, like, if I bring it up at the dinner table at a family event or something, because we're always talking, she doesn't want to talk about it. She just, it's terrified.
It scared her to death, huh?
Yeah, it totally did. Wow. And that's the thing else, the two people like, well, why don't you take a photo? Why don't you... Look, sometimes when these events are occurring, you, and I said this to somebody the other day, you have no way to describe what's occurring to you other than to stare at it. Like you're Pliny the Younger looking at the pyroclastic flow coming from, you know, the volcanic explosion. You're trying to describe something you can't understand sometimes. Yeah. So the last thing you think of is grabbing a camera. Or if you think of it and you run away to do that, you could be missing the experience.
Yeah, that's the whole thing I've talked with other people about too, when you don't have time. You know, I've wanted to take pictures of the eagles, the bald eagles that are around here, but by the time I get my camera, they're gone.
So right. I might as well just sit there and enjoy it. Same thing with the bees, right?
Yeah, I just sit there and enjoy it, man. And maybe I'm not supposed to capture that moment.
Right, but if I tell somebody that I had this bee moment, they're like, wow, that's amazing. But then if I tell them I saw some sort of cryptoid in my back field, they're like, are you sure you're okay, man?
Oh, Lorraine wants to know if you were allowed to drive the tractors and stuff when you were a kid.
Absolutely, baby. I was steering a wheel when I was 5. And I remember begging my grandfather when I was like 8 to have a job, like a bigger job on the farm. But I was baling hay, cutting the lawn with the little lawnmower when I was 7, like the little, because it was a pretty big, you know, farm property.
Yeah.
But we all had duties like that. That's, you know, a part of it. And sitting on my dad's lap because the driveway was kind of big. He let me steer the car and drive it down the road. 5 years old, man. So, and he was the chief of police, ladies and gentlemen.
The chief of police.
Yeah. For 15 years.
I don't know that I'd want my parents to be the chief of police.
Yeah, but you got to remember, those are different times.
Well, some of the things
And the public, you know, doesn't you see the militarized version of what the police have become.
Yeah.
This is a time frame when, that, you know, police, and I have a lot of respect for the police today, trust me. They have very dangerous jobs that they deal with.
Oh, yeah.
But if a cop saw you swigging a beer, throw it out, put it out. If a cop saw you doing, you know, you're speeding a little too much, slow it down. It wasn't an always throw the book at you factor. So it was very different times again, man. We're talking 1975, right?
Yeah, we're talking back then. Where things were a little bit more chilled out, and you know, they also would tell you that because it saved them paperwork.
Well, that too, but you also know. It's just like, come on, get your head together, you know.
Yeah, well, anyhow, how about your ghost experiences?
Well, that's my ghost experiences.
Or did you already tell them?
No. I mean, see, that's the thing is, other than the things that occurred in my house with, especially my grandmother, where she was touched a number of times by something in our basement, and so was my mom. There were some times in the house where you just knew you weren't alone, even though you were alone. And because that, and I still think it has something to do with the gentleman that had tragically died in the building of the silo, that it was him that was there.
What silo? Explain that situation about what silo?
Well, the silo that was built on the edge of the barn for storing grain and what have you was built many years ago in 1890 or something like that. And in the process of it being built, near the completion, a gentleman who had owned the farm, who was building it, one of his brothers, fell off and died instantly. So, as people know in the paranormal world, sometimes spiritual activity becomes connected to time frame, space. It can be there left in residual. It can be there in visitation. So, for me, that house had that. I had kids are so, I love kids, man. They're so perceptive to this still. So for me, having to go to the basement to get a bottle of beets or pickles was a task before dinner because I felt there's something going on down there. That a lot of people in the house didn't understand. So for me, that was a very early age. Feeling it was what that was.
Yeah.
I lost a really close friend about 8 years ago. And he died tragically in an ironic experience where he was the food and beverage manager for 13 years at a restaurant. He was poisoned by food. because he had a bad allergy to peanuts.
Does this have to do with the silo story? Because you're
I'm jumping because I wanted to get into that. I know we're limited on time.
Oh, we got a half hour yet, man.
Okay, good. Okay, well, the silo though, but it's okay. So I'm jumping back to what that was. So for us in our home, we had this feeling that there was something there. We didn't always talk about it all the time, but you could definitely sense what it was. And in some cases today, for me, looking at the negative aspect of the spiritual world, it still is part of things that I see in my own family hanging on in residual that we consider to be a negative thing that has affected people in our own family. So I have to pay very close attention to what that is as a person and recognize it for what it is for my own salvation. Salvation not just like on a spiritual level, but just being healthy, being, you know, taking care of myself, all of those kinds of things that are important. So with that said, none of us were ever hurt. We were never physically, you know, nothing was ever thrown at us. But still to this day, like, you know, something's going to happen. You just can't help but not think that, yes, this is why what it was. It's that initial impression. So, whether he's still there or not, I don't know. But, and we never had it officially checked out. There was no medium that was there. These are all the things that, you know, I felt or we felt.
Well, and what actually, kind of things happened with this guy? He fell from the silo when he was building it, and he was almost completed with it, and he fell. What kind of things happen, I mean, around the farm that you think that this guy is doing?
Well, like, here's the thing. I mean, our family has had an arduous amount of physical ailments in ways that are abnormal for one family to go through. And if I was to tell you what even my own mother has been through, between cancer, Crohn's disease, survived these kinds of things, my dad, multiple sclerosis, brain tumor, diabetes, multiple kinds of addictions that run through my family circle, all of those things really make me question, like, this doesn't make sense to me, because we were very healthy, active people, and for us to all have manifested, not me, I'm lucky, I'm knocking on wood, it doesn't seem right. And I think that's one of the things, if you listen to great mediums, physical mediums, and they're in locations, and this is what really set the hook for me in terms of my thinking about it, was that, yes, like, oh, I see a medium talk about it. Amy Allen's great for this. She'll be like, the reason that this person is like, there's was somebody here before and they had heart issues, and it's actually affecting the person that's living there now so much so that they've had multiple tests, a heart attack, and the doctors don't even know why. So I guess that's what I'm getting at, because it deals with health things. Okay. Things that are serious in nature, mortality issues, right? We're being affected by it on that level.
Yeah, I can understand that. I deal with that here sometimes, but it's on a simple level. I just have to take naps all the time because the people that died here, they were really old.
and that's why I guess I just making yourself aware of it so that it is something that you can keep in an arm's length.
Yeah.
And protect yourself in those situations. But at the same time, the positive aspect of those affirmation moments, like I jumped before talking about my friend that had passed. When he died, it's tragic. It's, you know, just married, 4.5-month-old baby boy. There were things that started to occur in my home, outside of my home. So for instance, during the wake, here we all are. We've gathered on a little pub. There's about 40 of us left. I'm out on the street. And I told you the story the other day when we were rapping.
Yeah.
These kids just start walking down the road, and I hear them chatting, and you can't help but not. It's nobody out on the street. It's quiet. And I can hear them saying, yeah, we got to break into a junkyard and steal a door and fix the car. And I could say that they're up to no good. And I hear it. So what first of all stupefies me is that I had done this when I was 18, 17, 16, where we took our friend's parents' car that we weren't supposed to. My buddy drove it into the side of their own barn. We wrecked the door. We tried to figure out a way to get into this crazy junkyard, to get a door, to bring it home, and put it, all of this stuff. I was like staggered. And then my buddy who had passed was a part of this. And our you know, kids will be kids. So I just stopped them and I said, look, I can't help but not like overhear your story. And I have to say, like, I'm blown away. A buddy of mine just passed away. We're inside right now. This exact same thing kind of happened to us. I can't believe that you guys are talking about it. Just, would you come in and meet my friends? Come on up. I know some of you might not be old enough, but just meet my friends. So we get to the top of the stairs, and everybody's in their chat mode. I can kind of take off my coat, and I said, hey, everybody, these three kids, you got it. Everybody gets quiet. I tell the story, and the whole room gets white. And I said, what did I say wrong? Like, I thought I did something wrong. And they said, Ed, we were just telling that story. So while I was down on the street, not privy to the story and conversation, although I know it, right, that was occurring. I'm on the street by myself. Three kids walk by telling the exact same story at that exact moment in time for me to be able to hear it. And then to take them in and to go upstairs and to have that happen. Now, to me, people are, well, that's coincidence. How? Tell me how that can be coincidence. How could three kids that did the exact same thing be walking at that same moment in time to be able to curtail the story to one another, to take them upstairs to another group of people who are talking about that story without any awareness of what's going on outside and vice versa? It's impossible. It's like trillions to one that could actually occur.
I don't believe in coincidence, man.
No, me neither. And I go, hey, it's my buddy. I started to laugh and cry almost at the same time because I'm like, right, confirmation, you love me. I'm going through all this shit because I'm still a human being living in my mortal coil, and You're past that, but I'm okay, Ed. You know, that's what it was. And I was staggered by it. And everybody that was there was like speechless. And the kids all thought that I brought up that they thought they'd done something wrong. I'm like, no, you don't understand. So like that for me is like a huge part of what I still, you know, am looking for or see. You know, the Jerry Garcia from The Grateful Dead wrote with Robert Hunter.
Yeah.
And Bob wrote with, I can't remember who Bob wrote with all the time again. But, you know, Robert once wrote a lyric that said, once in a while, you get shown the light in the strangest of places if you look at it right. And for me, that's what the paranormal is that, again, perception or being able to feel it and step outside of the machine to be able to feel it or to recognize it for what it is.
I agree with you. I agree with you 100% with that. To me, the paranormal is more like what people, it's, the paranormal is out of the norm that is the norm, and people don't want to accept something, so they have to put a label on it to be able to deal with it. And when it's just something natural, I mean, I've personally, in my past, I've had the phone ring and you go to answer it and didn't have caller ID, but there was nobody here, there, just static, and it kept ringing for hours, and then I unplugged the damn phone, and it continued to do the same thing.
Wow.
So, that was...
So, let me ask you this, man. Who was it?
I couldn't tell you who it was.
Gut really instinct, what was it first?
Well, I thought it was my ex-wife, and I thought it was my ex-wife telling me that things were okay and that she had died because something had told me that she had died, but she's still alive. So I have no idea.
Huh. Did anybody in her family pass?
Not at that time, no. Mm. Her mom passed a couple of years ago, but this was 15 years ago. Oh, shit. This was 20 years ago in Cincinnati, and I haven't been there in 20 years. So
For me, it would have to be far more readily connected on that level. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So like if all of a sudden you had that thought and it and you were you found out your ex-wife was alive, but then she just called out of the blue the day after and told you that her own mother passed, you know, it would be like, whoa, that's where your thought process, cognitive thought process, hopefully takes you to that. You know, I've had this even from the lady that we used to know, I mentioned before, Pat Krillick, where she works with medium groups, and she had a thing where somebody in our family was going to die, and she didn't expect it to be my father. She thought it was going to be my grandfather. Yeah. So all of that said, it was like she knew somebody in my family was going to die, but she didn't have the complete mathematics. That's the thing about this that people have to realize, which makes it unstable for the untrained eye or brain emotion or soul to be able to understand it.
I've got a good story. You'd enjoy this one. I've never told this story on the air before. I've told it to people in chat. In 1983, you are old enough, you may remember this, Ed.
Hit me.
All right. I had, me and my wife, we had a set of twins. One of the twins, the youngest of the two twins, had to have the operation because her food pipe and her windpipe were grown together and she could not eat. So she had to have the operation to have this fixed. Well, she always had problems throughout the whole year that she was alive. Me and the ex-wife got into a fight. I left. She left. And when... basically, my daughter was killed. And...
I'm sorry, man.
Yeah. Well, it's all right. Anyway, to go on about this without going into the depressive stuff, about, I think this was like maybe 3 years later. Because I was in college, and I had this dream. And the dream, my daughter came to me as a six-year-old girl or something like that in a dream. She took me to the cemetery where she was buried. She showed me that she didn't have a headstone. She was supposed to have a headstone. It was agreed upon about who was going to buy the headstone. And she didn't have that headstone. And then when I woke up just to go to college, there was toilet paper strung all through the house, the apartment. You know, I lived in an apartment at the time. It was in the bathroom. It was all over the house. And that's how I knew for a fact that it was my daughter Trisha telling me she didn't have the headstone. And so I got a hold of POMC, which was Parents of Murdered Children, and took care of the situation from there. And then years later, the situation was rectified. And she has a headstone. But that's my...
So in the dream, that's how you really first knew that she didn't have the stone. It wasn't until later you had confirmation.
It wasn't until later that I had confirmation, which was a few days later that I had confirmation. But I knew that was my daughter. I knew it.
You see, that's next to impossible for you to know through a dreamlike state.
I was told, as a matter of fact, yes, she has a headstone. This is who we're getting the headstone from, blah, 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 blah. I was told this, and she didn't have a headstone. And it's like, it was too painful for me. The stuff that I had gone through in my life up until the time I was in college and had this dream, I couldn't go back to the cemetery for the longest time until this. And I had to go to the cemetery to confirm. That was the only way.
You know? Dude, I can sympathize, man, because my dad is still sitting in an unmarked grave because of who he was. It's hard for me to go back there because for me I have to manifest the memory more so, like you just said, and not going to delve into the dark of it, the madness in the moment, and that still, you know, impregnates us, and we're left with the memory of what happened. So all that said, I'm trying to allow that to flourish in a different way. Even when I first moved back in farm country again, because where I grew up, Markham, sorry, that's the fire in the background, changed so much. I needed to have that wide open space existence. It was just getting crazy with subdivisions and strip malls and everything. It was just, regardless, when I got here, you know, my dad had been gone already, you know, so many years. I'm standing in the kitchen and the phone rings and it's my friend. And this is the catalyst. This is what I look at as the catalyst. A really old friend. Known him since I was five.
Excuse me a second, Ed. Do you get a fire going?
Yeah, sorry.
Okay, we hear the popping. And
I'm apologizing.
It's okay, man.
Yeah, it's the way I heat my home.
Yeah, it's all good. It's just, you know, people in the chat room, too, are going, is there a fire going?
Yeah, there's a fire going. Make it all spooky, right?
But go ahead and continue.
But oh, so I was talking about my dad and the fire.
Yeah.
Dad. Oh, so here I am. So my friend calls. He's my oldest friend. And we just moved in, and he calls us and congratulates us. And, you know, it's this wonderful moment between two old friends. And all of a sudden, you know, and senses are such, you talk about senses before, such an important thing. I could smell a multitude of things that were attached to him. Like my earliest memories of him, the aftershave he would use, his BO. It's just overwhelming. And you know, because my dad was such a busy person, if my parents were away and they were gone for a long period of time, and because my grandparents were living with us, we would go in their cupboard and, you know, smell, oh, mom and dad, you know, as kids, you know, you love mom and dad, they're paramount, right? So when I just started to weep, and I told my buddy, I said, Tobias, I said, my dad's here. And I started, and he's like, it's okay, man. He's like, he's telling you, he's happy for you. You know, and I was like, yeah, you're right. That's what it is. Like, you know, and again, recognizing it through my senses, smelling it in that way. People are like, well, it's crazy. You can't, what are you talking about? It's like, I can't describe it. All I know is that it happened. And I can't ignore it because I'm like, I've got a strong sense of smell. And what's more ironic is that he was a person of scent because he was also knighted in France, in Burgoyne, because his abilities to be able to smell and taste wine were so sophisticated, they knighted him.
Wow.
So for him to use that sense with me is another tall tale indicator that goes, Dad, right away.
Yeah. That's,
you know what I mean?
The other experience I could tell you with my daughter, I had a psychic. Back in the day, there was this place called Empire. I don't know if you remember it online. But anyway, the psychic told me that she goes, do you ever feel like somebody's playing with your hair and nobody's there standing behind you, but you feel like there's somebody playing with your hair? Well, yeah, I do feel that. She says, it's your daughter. And my daughter, she used to love to play with my hair when she was alive.
Oh, wow, man. And they asked you the question just out of the blue?
We were doing this. We had a chat room. It was a voice chat room, and we used to tell stories and talk about spiritual stuff and all this. And this woman who was a psychic came out and she told me this. And it's like, wow. Had I not been sitting down, she'd have knocked me in my seat.
Exactly, and that's the other. That's wild, man. Like. Because immediately you go to that baseline connection and go, oh, I mean, why would you just say that of all the things that you could have said? You know, that's the other aspect of it. Like, even when my wife lost her cousin in a tragic car accident, they sought out a medium that's very well known here in Canada. And the way that it works, you just leave your first name and a phone number. And there's a 1-year waiting list to get on the actual program and right. Go for your reading. While she was there and her cousin had come through the medium, at the same time, my friend who I just told you about came through and said, there's another boy here who is artistic with blonde hair and he's got a beard. And he's telling you, pointing at my wife, to tell your husband happy birthday. Which my birthday was the day after this appointment. And then she says, and there's another boy here with really curly red hair, and he's telling you to tell your husband he likes the little beard, the foo, under his chin. I was sporting a foo at the time. And that was my student who was just hit and killed by the train only 6 months earlier.
Wow.
To a T in description. There's no way. There's no way that woman could have known any of those things.
Right.
So again, it's confirmation on that subtle, for me, it's my personal experience, my wife's personal experience, her aunt who lost a child. But it brings that sense of validity and story. That's the important thing of story and culture and in family, for that matter, as you pointed out before. That the allegory, as I said, it's important because it also is showing and teaching you something about how you perceive and how you listen and how you pay attention. And those subtle moments that occur are very special. There are moments for them, you know, that and sometimes moments of stress that you wouldn't expect it to occur. Or sometimes when you think everything is fine and the ground falls up beneath your feet, all of a sudden there's a huge learning experience going on. You may not realize it, trust me, but at the same time, you're coming out the other end feeling completely different about it, hopefully.
Right. Okay, well, thank you so much for being here, and I'm going to have you back sometime if you want to come back.
Are you kidding? I love rapping with you, man. It's always a pleasure. Love the show and the idea and the concept behind it.
That's awesome. We filled 2 hours with no problem. I think everybody enjoyed the show. I do have one last question from Lorraine. She asked, on the lighter side of things, for both of us, this goes out to me and to you, where's the strangest place have you ever found a guitar pick?
Oh, wow. That's another crazy thing. Okay, wow. Amazing. Okay, great. Oh, girl, you're on fire. You're getting something from my buddy Bane, I think, now. Okay, I'm at the donut shop only like a month and a half, 2 months after all the fit has hit the shan and he's passed. And I'm getting a coffee and a sandwich. And as I walk out to the parking lot, the first thing I see in front of my car door is a green pick. And all on it, it says, is Brain. His name was Bane. And I picked it up. I still have that pick. And I just went, whoa. So for me, that's the strangest. I guess it sort of connects the whole story and everything with him. But yeah, that's the strangest place I've found a guitar pick.
Wow. I couldn't tell you where the strangest place I've ever found a guitar pick because I don't have a story like what Ed just told you.
Well, I mean, you know, it's just all, you know, I love life and I can't help but not get excited about it. That's all, dude.
All righty, man. So, all right. Well, you have a good night, and everybody out there in the listening land, you have a good night, good day, whenever you're hearing this show. You be well, be safe, and tell us bye there, Ed.
Bye, and it's so great to be on Black Swamp Radio. We had the hi-fi high, the lights down low. Listen to Black Swamp Radio.
And we will see you. Bye.